Investor Connect podcast program. This is Hall T. Martin. I'm the host of the show, in which we interview angel investors, venture capital, private equity, family offices, and many other investor groups for startups and growth companies. I hope you enjoy this episode. Thank you for joining us. Hello, this is Hall Martin with Investor Connect. Today we're here with Matthew Sullivan of QuantmRE. Matthew, thank you for joining us.
Cool, thank you. It's a pleasure to be on.
So what was your background before engaging in the blockchain sector where you're working now?
I've been involved in technology, finance, really since the late 90s, which was the very much the beginning of when the internet began to start its mass adoption. So blockchain really is it was faint signals from the future. So I've been involved in these types of fintech businesses really for the last 20 something years.
So what led you to pursue the blockchain sector at this point?
I think we get a handful of opportunities like this in our lifetime. And I think one of them was the internet back in the late 90s. And I can't really remember another opportunity that is as large and as impactful as the blockchain. So I was involved in creating billing systems for internet-based traffic way back before broadband, I think, was even invented. And seeing the developments in cryptocurrencies and the blockchain, really, as I said just now, it was faint signals from the future. The only caveat is that it took me a while to figure this out. So there were some people that were far more advanced and far more able to spot these trends and were able to get involved with cryptocurrencies and the blockchain several years before I did. So I'm certainly not one of the smartest people in the room, but just that experience of seeing and knowing that this is something that really is going to make some seismic changes to the way that we do everything. And it was a desire to get involved as an insider, as opposed to just simply watching from the outside and participating as a passive passenger, as it were.
So for those who want to invest in the blockchain area, what's your advice for them at this stage?
I think it's very similar advice to the advice that you would have been given at the early stages of the internet, which was then, 20 years ago, a very young, nascent technology. And blockchain technologies are still at a very early stage. So the advice that I would give is be prepared for a number of failures in the sector before the sector becomes stable and before you are able to predict likely outcomes. So in other words, blockchain and cryptocurrencies are an incredibly high-risk area if you are an investor. And it's not because there's anything wrong with the technology. It's simply because it's at such an early stage. Having said that, the velocity and the acceleration in growth and development that I've seen in the blockchain and that technology space is far faster than anything we ever experienced in the internet world 20 years ago. So the pace of growth, the pace of development is significantly greater. And that's a good thing for investors. And in addition to that, this is a global phenomenon. So this is not a technology that is related to certain, restricted to certain geographies. So I think it's my advice to an investor is get involved, be part of what's happening in blockchain, but be very careful where you place your money and be prepared for surprises.
Well, I've too noticed that the industry is changing very fast. The issues we had 6 months ago are gone and we have a whole new set of issues today. What do you think the issues will be 6 months from now, and how is that industry evolving?
I think the issues, these are growing pains and adoption pains and all the sort of things that you would anticipate with a technology that is beyond a technology. So, see, blockchain is not just a piece of tech. It's something where the application of blockchain has such an impact on people's lives. And that's why you see all of global regulatory bodies getting involved, because blockchain technology is being used to enable cryptocurrencies to act as value transfer mechanisms. So people are investing in cryptocurrencies. Cryptocurrencies have the potential to displace money in some respects as the ability to transfer value. So if you're talking about a technology has the ability to disrupt our current financial modus operandi, then that's why all of the regulators and all of the various government bodies around the world are getting involved. So these are not issues as such. What they are really is it's the explosive growth of a technology that has such an impact. And I think the issues that we will see will continue to grow, but they will be representative of the importance of blockchain within within the world. So the discussions will be endless, I think. So I know that doesn't really answer your question specifically, but I don't think we're going to see a narrow range of steps or issues or hurdles that we have to jump over in order to get mass adoption.
So as someone's investing in this space, where do you think they should be looking for to make investments today, given it is early stage and it is changing rapidly?
I think if you look at there's the metaphor of the gold rush, how if you look at blockchain as a current gold rush from a technical perspective, I think one of the sayings is that the people that made money in the gold rush were not the people that found the gold, it's the people that sold the picks and shovels. So my advice really is to look at the infrastructure players as probably being the companies that are most predictable and likely to have the most value. Because blockchain is such an early stage technology, it still doesn't have a defined set of robust, resilient infrastructure players. They're still in development. They're in an advanced stage of development in some cases, but there is still large opportunities for players to emerge and become primary players in the infrastructure side of blockchain. And some of those companies you won't have heard of. So there's still plenty of activity out there for new entrants into the marketplace that can become market leaders.
So if you were to invest in an infrastructure play, given that's the stage of development here, what would you look for to say that would be a good one versus not a good one?
First of all, you have to look at really the scope of what the infrastructure application is. So if it's a very narrow application that is suited to a particular industry, is it likely to be big enough? Because the areas, if you're looking at these types of technologies as a global phenomenon, then you need to look on a global scale really to find the big, to find the big wins. So, but there are a number of companies that have emerged in the last 12 to 18 months that look as if they could become world-class players in terms of creating application technology. If you think of what you're looking for is who is the next Apple? Who's going to be the market leader, but in the decentralized technological world?
So you're developing an application in this space as well. What are the challenges you're finding in developing one in this area?
The challenges really are making sure that we are able to build a platform that manages risk, security, and generates the same level of trust and resilience as banking-grade technologies do. The challenge or our requirement, the task that we've set ourselves, is to build a real estate trading platform that enables people to buy and sell fractions of real estate as easily as they would be able to buy and sell stocks or bonds. So the challenges for us really are, from a technology perspective, making sure we build it using the right combination of technologies that have not only stood the test of time, but also embrace new blockchain technologies as well. So there's that, the ability of creating something that has the security and resilience that people would expect. In addition to that, we're pushing the barriers of current regulatory environments because of the way that we need to use this technology and the way that that needs to operate within a highly regulated industry. And so it's an incredibly interesting and exciting and intellectually challenging position to be in. And it's exciting because you're seeing evolution, not only in capital markets, but in technology and in securities regulation. And it's a very exciting place to be.
Right. Well, I saw the security regulation take place with crowdfunding several years ago. It took them 3 years to put together the actual detailed rules. Do you think we'll see the same thing here, or do you think they'll move a little faster given the amount of investor money going into this space?
It is SEC, FINRA, FinCEN, CFTC, all of those bodies are reacting in an incredibly positive and proactive way, in my opinion, to embrace this technology because they understand the global nature of it and the incredibly rapid adoption. If you look at the adoption of crowdfunding, it's much slower. I think it's several degrees of magnitude lower than the velocity that we've seen in the adoption of cryptocurrencies. And the rate of investment in cryptocurrencies really has forced the regulators to take this seriously. And so because of that, we're able to look at existing legislation, the sort of legislation that was created under the Jobs Act, because that is very much fit for purpose in terms of the application of what many of these cryptocurrency requirements are. So things like Regulation D, Regulation A+, Regulation S, that means that companies can utilize blockchain technologies in a securities environment and still be compliant. And so the importance of the Jobs Act and the crowdfunding legislation can't really be overestimated, the importance in terms of cryptocurrencies, that is.
So that's the regulatory side of it. What about the technical side of it? We're dealing with brand new technology platforms here with new ledgers and new forms of providing all the trust and security and so forth. What's the challenges you see in using some of these technologies?
The two major challenges are scalability and security. And I think really those are challenges that are common to all of the blockchains. There's an enormous amount of investment that is being made on a daily basis to secure the blockchain because of the importance that it has in enabling trustless transactions to happen. And I think that's really what's going to propel, you know, blockchain technologies and their applications to the next level. So the challenges are really common to all blockchain technologies. And then there are secondary and tertiary challenges in terms of the specific applications specific blockchains use. But I think everybody is really convinced that if we can build a robust blockchain technology or technologies that can handle large numbers of transactions reliably and securely, then once that nut has been cracked, then we will be looking at mass adoption of these types of technologies very, very soon.
In the last few minutes that we have here, what else should we cover that we haven't?
I think really it's just the understanding of people in the early days of the internet. I think there are a lot of people that didn't really understand it and didn't take the time to understand it, particularly from an investor's perspective. They would sit on the sidelines, and when Amazon, for example, posted their results, there would be a huge outcry from people saying that they didn't understand the business model and how come they were still in business and they're a bookseller and it's never going to work. How could they possibly go up against the incumbents in the industry and expect to survive? And obviously, history has told us differently. So the one thing I really want to bring to people's attention is just to ask them to take time to look into what blockchain technology means and to actually begin to understand it so that they are better informed and better educated. I'm not suggesting that they leap in and make an investment, but really just to become involved in what I think is going to be one of the most seismic technological changes that I've seen in my lifetime. And we are probably likely to see, it's the most interesting pivotal point that we're likely to see in many years. So this is not a passing fad. Take the time to understand as much as you can, and then you can make informed decisions as to how you want to get involved.
Well, we appreciate your sharing your thoughts with us today. How best for the audience to get back in touch with you?
Well, our website, which is QuantmRE, as in QUANTM, QuantmRE, will be live relatively soon. There's a site that's up and running at the moment where you can leave your contact details. I'm also on LinkedIn, and Paul, as you kindly mentioned, you'll be putting the contact details in the show notes. So hopefully, if you have any questions, you'll be able to track me down and I'll be able to help you out.
Well, great. We'll put those in the show notes and hope to have you back after the site's live to talk further about topics related to the blockchain and your application in as well. Thank you so much for taking time to join us today.
Paul, it was a pleasure. Thanks very much.
Investor Connect helps investors interested in startup funding. In this podcast series, experienced investors share their experience and advice. You can learn more at investorconnect.org. Martin Martin is the director of Investor Connect, which is a 501c3 nonprofit dedicated to the education of investors for early stage funding. All opinions expressed by Hall and podcast guests are solely their own opinions and do not reflect the opinion of Investor Connect. This podcast is for informational purposes only and should not be relied upon as a basis for investment decisions.